choosing the ad show for your viewing pleasure. We know you have a million choices of programming, but really, where else would you see this kind of lineup? Here's what's on our show.
Why are there so few women creatives in advertising? Who's the Kiwi connection behind this British award winner? And does the Rugby World Cup commercial need ankle tapping?
The hit show Mad Men gave television viewers an insight into the scandalously sexist world of the 1960s advertising industry. Men made the ads and women, well, they made the coffee. Of course, things have changed since then, or have they? 50 years later, advertising agencies are full of high-powered women, except it would seem in the all-important creative department. Of 55 agencies in New Zealand, only one has a female creative director. To discuss this strange imbalance, we have columnist Tracey Barnett and independent creative directors Maggie, Mouat of boutique agency Lovely, and Karen Maurice-O'Leary, who's just set up her own agency, My Little Tornado. Tracey, you wrote a big article on this issue. What prompted you?
I did. Bad commercials that don't really address women. I guess what's interesting to me is the response that I got from it was really quite overwhelming. Almost all of it was from women, which was just kind of this little loud hallelujah, as well as from a significant amount of men as well. I think what got to me was what surprised me. It was this statistic that you mentioned. I was shocked and amazed that there's only one creative director in the senior top positions that actually create what we see, the final top banana, I should say, out of 55 agencies. And I thought that was a pathetic statistic and a huge indictment of the New Zealand advertising community. It's not terribly better in many other countries, but I know in the States, for example, they have about 18 to 20% of top creatives are women. So we have a long way to go. And you can counter that by the fact that 80%, or roughly 80% of all household spending is either influenced or directly controlled by women.
Yeah.
So you have this weird disconnect between 98 or 99% of men who are in the top jobs who are putting their male creative voice to address and try to read a market that's filled with 80% of women making the choices and being at the point of purchase.
Okay, very good point. In fact, we're going to take a look at one ad that you have mentioned before. This one's for Femcare. Check this out.
How do I feel about my period? We're like this. I love it. I want to hold really soft things, like my cat. It makes me feel really pure. Sometimes I just want to run on the beach. I like to twirl, maybe in slow motion. And I do it in my white spandex. And usually, by the third day, I really just want to dance. The ads on TV are really helpful because they use that blue liquid, and I'm like, oh, that's what's supposed to happen.
Okay, Tracey, what gets you about that advert?
Oh, I love it. I love it. You know, I would like to go on the record as saying that I, for one, have never gone onto a beach in a white diaphanous dress and held hands with my female friends and joyously danced around to celebrate the beginning of my period. And nor have I stood in a kitchen to dance and celebrate, you know, that my kitchen floor is clean or that my toilet smells good. And this actually shows women kind of taking the piss out of the industry that I call it Barbie-tizing,
yeah,
which is basically, in my mind, it's you can look at that doll and know that's supposed to represent a female woman, but it doesn't reflect any real woman that any of us really know.
Good point. Maggie, you've been in advertising on the creative side.
Was that the barbecue?
Go on. What do you think?
I don't think women are so attracted to being advertising creatives, perhaps. Like when I graduated from the design courses that I did, just about all of the students actually were really attracted to working in design agencies, and they went off and did those kinds of things, or illustration or film. But advertising was kind of seen as a bit of a kind of crass option. You know, people drove fast cars and went to wild parties, which of course for me I was going, perfect. This could be an option for me. So I went into advertising not long after I graduated, and I loved it. Like, I had such a fantastic time in that industry. It was brilliant.
Karen, what's your impression? Do you think there's a glass ceiling there for women?
When I first started as a creative, we were the only girl team that got hired in the agency. Well, we were the first girl team, I should say, to get hired, and it was all guys. But over the last 5 or 6 years, there's definitely loads more creatives coming through that are female. The top dog still is majority male, but there is a lot of females underneath them as well. And so a lot of the ideas that are coming through do have a female skew. I think the reason why they're not getting to the top spot is they work their way through, work really, really hard, and the job comes available, or they get to the right level they're supposed to be at, and their ovaries come up and go, babies. And we do lose a whole lot of really good creatives to go and be mums. And I mean, unless you're going to make the call to be a part-time mum, which is a pretty huge call to make,
yeah,
that's where a lot of them lose at the top shop.
Do you think it's affecting the advertising, the output, the kind of ads that we're seeing?
No, because I think there is a lot of females that are still part of the creative department. And I think if a male can be behind the creator of Sex and the City, then they can actually write a funny tampon ad as well.
Right. So do you guys think it matters?
I do, actually. I think that you can have 10 sous chefs that are fabulous at what they do, but if the guy whose name is above the door in the restaurant is the star chef who's actually designing the recipes, what comes out on the plate, what we see on our screens and on our billboards, is his vision and his taste. And I do think that's what's happening. There's this disconnect between the people who make it to the very top spot and the people who are doing very good work but don't ultimately get their vision out there. And that's why I think there's such a strange disconnect.
Maggie, do you think it matters?
When you get a brief, your job is to get inside the head of the person you're talking to. So whether they're young or old or their ethnicity, like, there's so many factors, and it is your job to understand the character that you're going to write that commercial for. And that that's a very separate to what you're actually talking about, which is the filter that all the ideas go through in the agency. Like, there are all these different factors, but I think that your gender, like for me, I go, oh, of course I've got an advantage writing ads for women. I'm a woman. But it doesn't mean on a day, if you gave four teams the same brief, that a guy might not write a better one that day. It just works that way.
Okay. After the break, we dissect an ad campaign to see who does what in an agency and why men and women end up on different teams.